Worship Center, we are so glad you chose to worship with us today, whether it's online or in person. Thank you for joining us today at Heartland Worship Center. Our desire is to connect, disciple, and activate your faith into our community. If you're a first-time guest with us today, we want to say a special welcome to you to Heartland Worship Center. If you'll take out your phone and get on your picture icon, hold it up to this QR code, it'll take you directly to a place where you can fill out your information so that we can better connect with you. Then, following the service, in the community room is our Next Step classes, which tells you all about Heartland Worship Center.
Don't forget, tomorrow night, Monday at 7 p.m., is the workout class, the Revelation Wellness. If you have any questions, see Amy Krause. And at 7 o'clock, come in the north door in the community room.
Now the fun, exciting part of the service where we begin our first act of worship, which is tithes and offerings. So get your tithes and offerings ready, and we're going to bring those forward and put those in the offering plate so that God can, ministry can move forward. So stand with me, get ready, and as the worship team begins, we're going to take up the tithes and offering. And so this is when I say, Crystal, take it away.
The team is ready. God is so good. We are so glad you are all here. It seems like each week we get more and more and more, and that's awesome to see more faces in this place. Amen. And those that are watching online, we're so glad that you're joining us as well. How many of you are ready to worship? All right. Woo.
Life begins and ends in the dust.
unstoppable in his pursuit of you.
I have taken on your today is your faithfulness, and I will live in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will.
You still are faithful. And Lord, we give you praise and glory and honor for these things, Lord. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. All right, slap your neighbor a high five and tell them you are so glad they are here today. Amen. Amen. So, we have a couple new additions to the church this morning. Brinley is still, like, out. So, either she's going to sleep during the sermon or she's going to amen me. And then Randall's over there. He's wide awake, right? He's ready to amen me, so we're good. Amen. It's always good. See, when you have babies in the house, it makes my preaching so much better. Because you start focusing on them babies and not worried about what I'm saying. No. Just kidding. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I don't know about anybody else, but I feel jazzed today. Hallelujah. It's a good day to be in the house of the Lord. So with that being said, we are going to just jump right on into the Word of God today. And over the past 3 weeks, we started this series on Easter Sunday. When we started this series, The Final Words of Jesus on the Cross. And so we're going to kind of pick up there. Let me just kind of give you a review. The first words that we discussed in the first week was, Father, forgive them. I don't know about anybody else, but I need forgiveness. Anybody else in here need forgiveness? The rest of you are going to need forgiveness because now you don't know that you need forgiveness. Second week, we talked about, my God, why? When Jesus was on that cross, he looked up to heaven and he said, my God, why? Has anybody ever questioned God? The rest of you are lying. We're going to talk about that today too, okay? And then last week we talked about it is finished, the words that Jesus spoke from the cross, it is finished. But this week we're going to look at some of the most hopeful words that Jesus uttered for those of us who are in despair and those of us that have no hope, for those of us that admit that we need a Savior. And the words were when Jesus was on the cross and he said, today you will enter into paradise. And that's what I want to kind of look at today is those words that Jesus uttered to that thief on the cross. He said, today you're going to be with me. I don't know about anybody else, but if Jesus says that to me, I'm like, yes. You know, I'm going to learn my dance here. I feel like dancing this morning, but I was restraining myself. Hallelujah. So the question today, this is a very real question in this world that we live in today. Is what does it take for us to to get to heaven. Now, for those of you that have been in church at any for any length of time, maybe you grew up going to Sunday school or whatever, Bible studies, and you know this verse, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should" what? "Not perish, but have everlasting life," right? Okay, so the Bible teaches us that God sent his sinless Son, the innocent Lamb of God, who did something for us that we couldn't do for ourselves, okay? He gave his life for the, and he died a cruel death upon the cross. On the third day, he raised from the dead, and God caused the stone to roll away, right? And the grave became empty. So the Bible teaches us that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, defeating death, hell, and the grave, and sin, hello, right? For all by having faith in the perfect work of Jesus, our sins are forgiven. So we're going to kind of look at this story this morning. And Mark, I'm kind of just a little echoey today, so if you can kind of help me out there. But I love the story, and I don't think this is a true story, but hey, you know what? When you read it on Google, it's got to be true. But anyway, there were the two Roman soldiers standing at the tomb of Jesus' tomb, and the tomb was empty at this moment. One soldier looked at the other soldier, and he said, "We're dead meat." The other told him, said, what are you talking about? What do you mean? And the other guy says, "Don't worry about it. You know, just because this guy's no longer here, don't worry about it, man, because a year from now, nobody will remember what happened." Right? I don't think that's true, because approximately 2,000 years, we're still celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? And that's what we're going to talk a little bit about. So I've got a question for you today. When we lie, when we tell a lie, okay, does God frown upon us? Or what if we lie more than once? And at any point, do our lies make us no longer right with God? Or was we not right in the first place? Because we lied. Because we told a lie, do we now have to do something good to make up for that lie? How do we determine if we're right with God? Does God look at our good works and see if they outweigh our bad works? Right? Or does he see if our bad works outweigh our good works, or does it really even matter at all, our works? It's just kind of, is it just kind of whatever we believe that we choose to believe, or is it, we believe this way, does this make it right, this way? There's a lot of different ways out there that people believe. So how do we know if we're right with God? Because depending on what church you go to, depending on what denomination you go to, they believe in all works. You know, you got to do all these things, and I'm not knocking any religion, that's just what it is. If you go to a Catholic church, you go confess your sins to a priest or whatever, and it tells you you have to do something to get right, okay? You know, the Mormon faith, they believe you got to do different. So there's a lot of beliefs out there that believe you have to do something to get God to kind of smile on you, all right? But the question I'd like to ask you today is this, and I want everybody to think this through: are you right with God? If we take just a moment, just take a second, and you know, if we could play the video screen of your life across the screen, well, based on what your past tells you, that you'd be right with God. If something happened to you at this moment on this earth, what would happen to you? Would you go to heaven? Would you go to hell? Are you in a right relationship with God? That's a very, very real question that we've got to answer today, okay? So we look at Jesus' final words. We'll kind of let them unpack some things for us as we go through it. But before we do this, there's four categories that people typically fall into when we ask this question about, are we right? And I want to see if you fall into one of those four categories. So the first one is, a lot of people will say, you know, I'm secure, but I'm kind of unsure. You know, it's a tough place to be in. They are really right with God, but they just don't have that peace about it, and they're unnerved continually, okay? Then there's another one who feels sure, but they're not secure. They believe in religion, they believe in good works or whatever, but in reality, they're not secure with God, because there's always something more they got to do, right? Then there's another group that would say, I'm not sure and I'm not secure, and quite frankly, that's probably most of the people today, all right? Well, I don't know. I kind of sort of think I might be, but I'm not really sure. Haven't really given it much thought. Do you know anybody like that? Then the fourth category would be those of those people that would say, I'm secure and I'm sure. Hello, I hope we're in that number, amen? And as we study God's word, our prayer today is that these words of Jesus on the cross would take us beyond a shadow of a doubt till we are secure and we are sure with our faith in Christ. So how do we achieve that position with God? So today we're going to answer these three questions on how to become secure and sure with God, all right? So question number one, and you might want to write this down, and this is kind of an introspective question. Do you see your need? Question number one. Do you acknowledge that you have a need of forgiveness and a need of a Savior? Okay? In fact, there are two criminals hanging on each side of Jesus, okay, on the cross, these two thieves, and I would argue that they represent either one of us, okay? The Bible says the repentant one said to the arrogant one in verse 41, he said, we are punished justly for we are getting what our deeds, deserve, okay? In other words, we are guilty and we deserve punishment. What about you today? Do you see your need? And the truth is, a lot of people say, no, I don't see my need for God. Pastor, I haven't done that much wrong. I'm a pretty good person. I try pretty hard to be kind. I've never killed anybody, you know. I'm not as bad as Alan. I mean, come on. I just seen the elbow go flying there. And Pastor, I kind of sort of pay my taxes every once in a while whenever I don't cheat all the time. I should be okay with God. A lot of people simply don't see their need for God. So let me kind of help you out this morning as we kind of dive into this question. I need everybody in here to participate with this, okay? This is audience participation. If you don't participate, I get to call you out, okay? And it'll be on Facebook and for the rest of eternity, and everybody will know it's you, okay? So I'm going to ask you this question, and I want you to raise up your hand if this is you. Has anybody in here ever told a lie? Good, okay, so, all right. Whew. If you didn't lift up your hand, you're probably a liar right now. Okay, but that's your business. And so, if you've told a lie before, what does that make you? A liar. Thank you. If you told a lie, it makes you a liar. So, now, this is one of those things that I'm trying to help you see your need for a Savior, okay? Oh, here's a good one. How many of you in here have ever gossiped? Gossiped. Yeah. All right, put your hands down. How many of you in here have ever gossiped about Pastor Danny?
Yes.
Thank you for being honest, Grant. I appreciate that, buddy. The rest of you, I got you on video. I'm knocking on your door. So what's that make you? A gossip. So it's no longer just the little ladies on the telephone committee. You've just added yourself to that number. Okay? How many of you ever stolen anything? I mean, you sit there and go, oh, Pastor, I've never really stolen anything. But yet you'll walk away from work with pens and pencils and papers and things like that actually don't belong to you, but you think, it's just a pen. Did you steal it? Did you ask for permission to take it home with you? If you did not, you stole it. So what does that make you? A thief. You guys are getting really, really good at this. Okay, next one. How many of you would say that you've put something ahead of God before your own life, in your own life? Okay, so what's that make you? An idolater. Wow. you guys are some messed up people. So what you're telling me is you're a liar, a gossip, a thief, and an idolater. Every one of us. Me too, right? This is what we are. Now, does that mean that we deserve to be right with God? Mm-mm. It doesn't mean we deserve it. Do you see your need right now? So let me tell you what I deserve. And this may upset some of you. This is hardcore truth this morning. I don't deserve to be a pastor. Hello. Why? Because I've cheated, I've lied, I've gossiped, I've stolen. Hello. Are you hearing me this morning? What do I deserve? What do I deserve? I don't know about you, but I know what I deserve. Because according to the Bible, it says this is the punishment for death or for sin. The wages of sin is death. Is lying a sin? According to the Bible, stealing a sin? Gossip a sin? Idolatry a sin? What does sin deserve? Death. The wages of sin is death. What's interesting to me about this is next to Jesus, there are two thieves hanging on the cross. Both thieves were guilty, just like you and I are guilty of lying, cheating, stealing, gossiping, idolatry, okay? Both these thieves heard the same exact thing coming from our Father, Jesus. Both thieves were suffering severely. They were dying. Both thieves needed a Savior. Every one of us needs a Savior because we're nailed on the same cross. One recognized, oh, you got to get this morning. One of them recognized he had a need, and one didn't. Do you recognize your need? What's always kind of amazing to me in church is two people can be sitting together side by side. One person can be getting it, right? One person can be totally engaged in what God is speaking to them, totally engaged in the presence of God, totally engaged in worship of our Father. And the other person can kind of sit there and kind of looking like he's one of those glazed Krispy Kreme donuts that Fred brought this morning. Just like, one guy can be like totally grabbing, the other guy can be like, come on, Pastor, we got to beat the Baptist to church, to the food, right? One person sees their need and the other person doesn't. Do you see your need? That's the question. You may say, well, you know, Pastor, I'm kind of exempt from that. I'm kind of above that. Well, let's look at the Bible. What's the Bible saying? For how many have sinned? Every one of you lying, thieving, sneaky little gossip, he's talking about me. Hello? We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. Question number two. Number one, do you see your need? Number two is this, and you need to ask yourself this question. Who do you say Jesus is? Who do you say Jesus is? In Luke 23, verse 40, the repentant criminal said, we already got this communication thing going, me and Braylon, and you can hear up there. And then if Brindley starts in, and then if Randall starts in, I'm going to cut the sermon really, really short. But Luke 23, 40, the repentant criminal said this to the other one, don't you fear God, speaking to Jesus and speaking of him. Don't you fear God, this man has done no wrong. Even the criminals on the cross realized there was something different about Jesus. He was sinless. He's done nothing wrong. So who do you say Jesus is? And you've got to answer that question for yourself right now before you go anywhere else. Who do you say Jesus is? Now, so some people would, you know, kind of the wackadoodles would say that, yeah, Jesus really wasn't a real person. He's kind of a guy in a storybook. But we have to acknowledge the fact that Jesus lived in a very real time on this planet in human form. But the question is, who do you say is he a great teacher? Just a great teacher? Is he an incredibly nice guy with some kind of whacked out theories? Was he a guy that had power from somewhere to raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out demons, open blind eyes? Was he simply a man who, for whatever reason, split time in half on his death, BC and AD? Or was he the sinless Son of God, the innocent Lamb of God, who gave up his life in our place because of our sins? And on the third day, he rose from the dead. So who do you say he is, church? Who do you say it is? Not what your husband says, not what your wife says, not what your mama, your daddy, your friends say. Who do you say he is? Now, Jesus asked this very question at different times. One time he asked Peter. He said, hey, Peter, who do others say that I am? And Peter said, well, they say that you're a lot of things, teacher. And then Jesus directly at Peter says, no, but Peter, what about you? Who do you say that I am? And Peter answered this. He said, you are the Christ, you are the Son of the living God. I'm kind of amazed at that Peter recognized that, and yet still Peter denied Jesus three times. Who do you say he is? When I look into Scripture, it's interesting to me to see who others said that Jesus was. When God looked at the baptism of Jesus, remember when Jesus was getting baptized? And the Bible says heaven opened up and God spoke. He said, this is my Son whom I'm well pleased. When Judas, you remember, betrayed Jesus? What did Judas say about Jesus? Judas said, I've betrayed innocent blood. When Pilate condemned Jesus to a horrible death on the cross, Pilate said, I found no fault in this man. Pilate's wife said, have nothing to do with this just man. Who do you say Jesus is, church? Let's look at his life. Scripture tells us this, that Jesus did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing, humbled himself to take on the very nature of a servant, became obedient even unto death at the cross. So when Jesus was born, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he was born in a place. Or was he born in a palace? No. He was born in a humble stable surrounded by servants and animals. When Jesus died, how did he die? Was he on a throne? No. He died on a cross. He died the death of a criminal. Did he bear a crown of gold? No, his crown was thorns. Was he surrounded by worshipers and servants? No. He was numbered with the transgressors, the Bible says. He was surrounded by thieves, and when the enemies hurled insults at him and man did their worst, Jesus looked up to heaven and he did his best. He said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Who do you say Jesus is? Is he just the man in the storybook, or is he your Savior today? And if he's not, I'm going to introduce you to him before we get done. When he spoke those faithful words, I thirst, they gave him vinegar to drink, fulfilling the last of dozens of prophecies that were all perfectly fulfilled on the cross. Jesus looked up to heaven and he said, Tetelestai, it is finished. It is accomplished. It's perfect. The work has been done. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And with that, he said, no one takes my life, but I lay it down on my own accord. He gave his life, and 3 days later, the Bible says he rose again undefeated. Who do you say Jesus is? That's a question that you've got to answer this morning. So number one, do you see your need? You lying, cheating, corrupting. You church man, welcome to HWC anyway. Do you see your need? Number two, who do you say he is? And the third one is this. Have you experienced his grace? Oh, this is good. Have you experienced the same grace that this criminal on the cross experienced when he cried out, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom? And Jesus said the most grace-filled words ever recorded in history. Now, this dude couldn't do any good works, right? He was on the cross. I just blown away the theory that you've got to work your way into heaven. Okay? He could do nothing religious to earn his way into heaven, church. Does it mean we just sit back and do nothing? No. We still do our work. But that's not what gets us into heaven. We do our jobs because that's what we do to please our Father. Jesus, remember me when you enter your kingdom. Jesus said to that man, today I tell you the truth. Today you're going to be with me in paradise. Do you see your need? Who do you say he is? Have you experienced his grace? Because the hardcore truth of this matter is this. You are one of the two thieves hanging on the cross. In fact, the Bible says you can consistently find yourself in one of these two places. Just like next to Jesus, these two crosses, these two thieves. Remember, the Bible shows us that you fall into one of two places. Do you know that the Garden of Eden, you had one of two choices? There was a tree of knowledge of good and evil, and in that tree you die. There was also the tree of life, and that tree of life you get life. Remember, you're in one of two. The New Testament shows us that we are in one of two representative people. We are either in Adam, and the Bible says in Adam we die. Or are you in Christ? In Christ we live. Jesus said one day when he returns, you may be in one of two places. You may be in the field. And Jesus says if you know him, you'll be taken up. But if you don't know Jesus, you'll be left behind. And in all reality, you are one of those two thieves hanging on one of those crosses. If you remember, both thieves wanted to be saved, right? The one thief, hurling insults, says, hey, you saved others. Why don't you save you and save us if you're the man? We're always asking God to prove himself instead of just accepting him by faith. And the one thief said, don't you fear God? This man's done nothing wrong. Jesus, remember me when you enter in your kingdom. So what does it take to get to heaven? Do you see your need? Do you acknowledge that your sin separated you from God? Number two question, who do you say Jesus is? Is he a hero? Is he a great figure in history? Or is he the Son of God, the risen Christ, your Savior? The third question, have you experienced the grace of Jesus? You see, many people would say to get to heaven, you have to do good works, you have to be good enough. But if that was all it took, Jesus didn't have to die for our sins. I got news for you peeps. You can't do nothing good enough to earn your way into heaven. It's a gift from God. The criminal on the cross who was forgiven, he could do no good works because his hands were bound to the cross. He could run no errands of mercy because his feet were nailed to the cross. The criminal who was forgiven couldn't be baptized in water. Hello? He couldn't turn over a new leaf. He couldn't join the church. My goodness. If he could have just joined HWC, he would have been legit. All that thief could do was throw himself on the grace of God. The Bible says, for it is by grace that you are saved through faith. This is not of yourself, it is a gift from God so that nobody can boast. Doesn't matter what you do, it matters who you know. You are never saved by works. The Bible says, only by grace. You are one of the two thieves on the cross. Which one are you? One rejected Christ. The other threw himself up on the mercy of Jesus. Jesus, remember me. Some of us need to say that today because we've been teeter-tottering in this thing called life. We're not quite sure if I died today, if I was going to go to heaven. I'm telling you what, that's got to be the scariest position for anybody to be. I want to know that I know that I know that if today's the last day that this body takes a breath, that as soon as my last breath is gone, I'm in heaven. Hello? It's so important to grab a hold of this morning. You can't earn your way into heaven, but it doesn't mean you stop working for God. Worship team, come on up here this morning. I'd like you just to bow your head and close your eyes for a moment. And I want us to kind of think through this just for a moment. I want to just ask Jesus to speak to our hearts today. Because if you're in one of the categories other than I am secure and I am sure that if I took my last breath, that I would go to heaven. If you don't know that for sure, then we need to talk to you this morning. Because there's a lot of people that don't recognize that they have a need. I'm telling you what, every one of us are undone. Every one of us are unclean by the standard of the Word of God. Not by what I say, but by what God says. And if you're in here this morning and you're going to say, Pastor, I've struggled. I've accepted Jesus, but I still struggle with living my life in the remembering my past. My past always comes back to beat me up. And I want to help you out this morning. Jesus says that when he forgave you, he took your sins and threw them away as far as the east is from the west. Do you know you can keep going east and you'll never go west? But when you go north, eventually you'll turn around and come south. When Jesus said he threw your sins as far away as the east is from the west, never to be remembered against you, it means that they are gone for good. And quit allowing the enemy of your faith to bring up your past. Allow Jesus right now to speak to your heart, to get to that point where you are secure and sure. If you're in this house right now and you say, Pastor, I'm kind of teetering. I don't really know whether if Jesus came back today or whether I took my last breath, if I would make it to heaven, and it's kind of got on me just a little bit. I feel like I'm one of those thieves on the cross that's been just, you know, hey, God, just get me off here. Save my bacon. But you really don't have a heart change. You're the one I need to talk to this morning. Jesus wants to minister to you right now. So if you're in here this morning, you say, Pastor, I need a Savior. I recognize my need. I recognize the fact that I'm undone. I recognize the fact that, yeah, I've sinned so much in my life. And you need a Savior right now. I want you to raise your hand. Just raise your hand. You don't have to come to these altars. I want to pray for you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Let's pray right now. Father, Lord, you've seen the hands, Lord, that was raised up, Father. Lord, you've seen these people that recognize the fact that without you, they're not secure and they're not sure. So this morning, I pray that your Spirit will begin to move in their heart and their life right now. And just as the thief said on the cross, and here's what I want you to say this morning, church. That thief, he didn't have the Romans road of salvation. He didn't have a big prayer. All he said to Jesus was, remember me. And then Jesus said, today, you're going to be with me in paradise. So look, I don't have any fancy hoops for you to jump through this morning. If you raise your hand and you mean it so sincerely that you need a Savior in your life, all you need to say is, Jesus, remember me. Remember me. And you know what he's going to do? His Spirit is going to fill you up. And then all of a sudden, you're going to recognize that things in your life that don't need to be there, the things that hurt God, that break his heart. And he's going to begin to convict you of those things. And when he does, you just walk away from them. Whatever it is, you just walk away from it. Because that's separating you from God. Sin separates us. But all you got to do this morning, remember me, Lord. Remember me. Hallelujah. Worship team, go ahead and begin to play. Would you stand with me this morning, church?
To be in my life.
need. I need you. I don't need anything else but you. I know what my sins deserve. And but by your grace, ooh, you said, your blood has made my sins as white as snow. So God, clean them up. Never to be remembered against me. Thank you. You are the Christ, the risen Son of God. And I thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love and your mercy. In your mighty name, we pray. Amen. If you have not experienced his grace, you need to experience the grace of God. It'll blow you away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Whew. All right. Why don't y'all sit down for just another second, please? We got just the... Jason, would you go ahead and grab... Can you give me that mic down? Where'd that mic go? We'll give just a second. We got a little transition, a little announcement to make today, and it's kind of one of those bittersweet things. Don't want to let the cat out of the bag too soon. God is good, amen? God has, he's never surprised. He plans, he orchestrates things, and so this is a plan. Yes, what you're hearing up there is thunder. The children of thunder. They got a crew up there today. Oh, my word. They're probably thankful that I cut it short today. My baby girls. Come on up, guys. Hun, you want to join me up here on this stage? I don't know if I can. In life, there's the transition in ministry. And I don't know, probably for the last couple of years, we've been having this conversation. And Jonathan and Katie have accepted a senior position, a lead pastor position in Windsor, Missouri. Yeah. Give them a hand because. We read 4 years, you know, 4 years. She's going to help me take care of this church, and it's almost 10 years that they've been here. It'd be 10 years in October. This right here, you don't ever hardly see in the ministry where we get to actually watch. They came in empty-handed, two dogs, and those two dogs. I'm still praying to get over my animosity about those.
They're both in hell. They're both in heaven.
But. They're leaving with two amazing little people and two other dogs. Which actually, I like these other dogs better because they haven't tried to bite me yet. But Jonathan and Katie, they accepted this position May 9th. Mother's Day will be Jonathan's last Sunday here. May 23rd will be Katie's last Sunday here because Katie's got a lot more work to do up there than Jonathan did. So we didn't want to... So that's going to be the kind of the transition. Jonathan is going to give us his farewell message next week. So make sure you plan to attend that. You'll get to see him blubber. I'm sure you're going to see that. I asked him this last week. I said, "Hey, what are you going to be preaching on your first Sunday at Windsor?" He goes, "Pastor, I'm trying to get through my farewell message here." So what I'm going to do is just kind of give them the mic and just kind of let them greet you. And again, this is a good thing. It's never about money in the ministry. Because if it was about money, we would never go into the ministry. Yeah. I'm just being serious if it was all about money. But this is a calling. Yeah. I knew that God had his hand on this guy, you know, and he would be pastoring his own ship before long. And that's the reason we started walking in those steps and started looking at it. And I just said, just be honest. Let me know where you're going at. Let me know if you're trying out, and I'll help you. And so when I got the first call from the church, or actually the superintendent or something, or one of the executives down there, I made him sound like he walked on water. No. Not that I want to get rid of them, because this is totally bittersweet. I've never had somebody this close to me as far as being able to hunt with and just be able to do life with. It's just been really, really cool. And it's a really hard thing for me to let them go, but it's a God thing. So you guys want to say something? Go ahead.
We just had to say goodbye to the kids. From the time that I was called into ministry at 10 years old, I knew that eventually my calling was to be a senior pastor. So this is 26 years in the making. Like Pastor Danny said, we came here thinking 4 or 5 years, and now we're working on 10. And that's because of you guys. Like, HWC, you guys are our family. And you have loved us. You have spoiled us. You have treated us like your own, and it's hard to leave that. And even though we are 100% convinced that this is where God has us, where he wants us to be, I could list a dozen different things that God has either closed or opened along this process to confirm to us that this is where we need to be. That does not make leaving here and sitting up here today and telling you guys this any easier, because we love you. And you guys have loved us. I'm going to get into some more of this stuff next week. If I can get through it, I'll be honest. Like, it's rough to try to put into words what you guys have meant to us and mean to us and our family. The fact that you have been here every step of the way with Maddox. For years when we were trying to get pregnant before Era was born, this is where we found comfort and prayer. And we love you guys. We love this church. We love Pastor Danny and Angie. You guys you came in and you've let us do our thing, and you have loved us and treated us like your own kids. And we can never thank you guys for everything that you've done for us. And we are excited for what God has for us in the future, but we're also really excited for what God has for HWC. And I know that we have built relationships here that are going to be lifetime relationships, and that we'll be able to celebrate life for many, many more years to come. And so just thank you for these last 9.5 years. It's weird because, and I've said this a few times, besides Katie, Pastor Danny's the longest relationship that I've ever had. And I'm starting over, so it's kind of weird. We love you guys, and thank you so much for these past 9.5 years. HWC is home. It will always be home for us. I'm going to ask her, and I know what the answer is, but Katie, do you have anything you want to say?
Hey, Katie's going to sing a song next week for me.
Arrow.
I've been trying for 10 years to get Katie to sing, and I'm gonna just continue to do that.
Maddox, do you want to say something? Everybody?
No. You just like mama?
Yeah, that's it. Here you go.
Oh, and mark your calendars. May 21st is a Friday night. That's going to be our going away party for these guys. We're just with a schedule, with everything that we're trying to juggle. Pastor Jonathan is going to be driving back and forth to Windsor. It's Windsor, Missouri, which is just north of Clinton, Missouri, a little bit. So they're going back to the Mecca, Southern Missouri District. So we're excited for them, but there's a lot of transition. The May 28th week, Memorial Day week, is the week that they're actually going to be vacating and heading on down there with their U-Hauls. So all you people out there for the last 9 years that we've helped move, payback. It's time for payback. But anyway, we'll get more of that information out as time gets closer. And the other thing is the Children's Church is going to be in great hands. Ms. Hannah Taff is, she's agreed. Yeah. Thanks. Hannah is going to be leading children's ministry up there, and so she's going to be shadowing with Katie these next several weeks, and so there's a smooth transition with that. So there's going to be a lot of changes that we take their church through. But when you have somebody that's been here for 10 years and then all of a sudden they're gone, there's just voids that we're going to be working on and filling up. All right, stand with me. Let's just pray over these guys right here. We're going to pray again over them. Before we let them leave on the 21st. But if you just extend your hand out here, and let's just We're going to send them away with our blessing, because that's exactly the way God said. So, Heavenly Father, Lord, we lift up, Lord, this family to you, God. Lord, I pray right now for your anointing, Lord, to be upon them. Lord, at every step of the way, Lord, you've ordered, God. And Lord, I pray, Father, for Windsor Assembly, Lord, that there will be such an outbreak of revival in that church when Jonathan and Katie and the kids get there, God. Lord, that you'll put leaders in their pathway, faithful leaders, God, people that will get right behind them, the vision that they have for that church. And Lord, that we will see great and mighty things, Father. And Lord, we send them away with our blessing, Father. As hard as it is, God, Lord, we know this is your thing. It is your calling. So, Lord, we ask, Father, Lord, from every little aspect of this move, Father, Lord, that there would be safety, Lord, that the vehicles will run exactly the way it's supposed to, that, Lord, as they load up their stuff, Lord, it'll all be transferred just perfectly, God. But, Lord, more than that, I pray your anointing to be upon this family, their kids, as they go into new school systems, Father. Lord, I pray that transition be so smooth. And, Lord, we thank you for that. And we bless them in your mighty name. Amen. Hey, and on the 21st, if you, they're not going to turn down nice little gift cards or little cards that have a little something in them. We're going to bless them, but that's just what we do. Hello, we're a giving church, and so don't forget that when we come in and we do the whole cake thing and whatever. All right, let me bless you guys. Father, HWC is your church. Those that come and go, Father, Lord, it's of your will. And so, Lord, we ask right now that you bless this church. Lord, I pray that you'll bring us, Lord, seven times, Father, the number of people that we are going to, when we lose Jonathan and Katie, give us seven times as more that will replace them, Father. Lord, the leadership, Lord, the skills and the abilities, Father, in your name we pray. Amen. All right, God bless you guys. You guys can head on out there and...